Alright, Mr. Hobo, we're on your skeleton. 150, which is definitely a unique skeleton. Sorry about that. I had to press pause. One of the old youngsters was walking up to me yelling and stuff. Anyway, man, you can look at all four schematics of skeletons. This doesn't match any one of them. Somebody's been in here putting components on here, like a 230 picofarad cap. I mean, that's not on any of the schematics. But here's the one thing that I noticed very quickly that I couldn't believe I didn't notice the first time I looked into this. Take a look at what somebody has done. It's kind of funny, but I've never seen this happen before. All right, you see this capacitor right here? This is a 10 picofarad capacitor. All right. As many of you know, capacitors do not allow DC to flow through them in series, only AC. Somebody has this capacitor soldered from the input to the output, which means this amplifier is not going to work. The RF coming in is going to be going straight to the output as well. So that's going to put the input to the output. Now, the first time I hooked this up, I was getting some very dramatic input reflecting no output. I'm hoping it's because of this. I must admit, I've never seen anybody tie the input and output in together like that with a capacitor. But so I can't really say what's going to happen once I remove this. I'm hoping the amp's going to work just fine at that point. But I would love to know what somebody's reason behind that was. Maybe they were somehow getting it confused with the 10 picofarad cap right here, sending it over to for the keying circuit. I don't know, but that right there is something I've definitely never seen someone do before. So we're gonna get that removed and try to get this thing back up and working. Hopefully there isn't a blown transistor. I thought there was, but now that I've noticed that, I'm not too sure. So we'll see. These aren't fun to work on, I will admit to that. No gatekeeper, we'll be back. Alrighty, Mr. Hobo. We got your skeleton here done, man. I'll tell you what, man, this it wasn't these things aren't the easiest things to work on, bar none. I mean, I ain't gotta tell you why. If you got to replace a transistor or something like this, you're going to have to break this whole amp down. I mean, you're going to have to take it completely apart, which is what I had to do. You had a blown 455, okay, and the other 455 was not blown. And where is that 455? I think it's somewhere over here in this pile. So, I could send that 455 back to you, or we could trade it in towards the cost, because you never know when I might need a 455 or something for a repair in the future. I always like to give my customers that option instead of just keeping it. I ain't gonna say no names, but I know I've definitely had it done to me when I was first getting into this thing. Send something off to get it repaired, and there might have been something valuable or brand new that was still in the box, and it was kept without asking me if I wanted it back. So anything valuable like that, I always like to check with the customer and see if they'd like it back or if they'd like to trade it towards the cost of the box. But anyway, what we went ahead and done for you, brother, I did not have two 455s that were used laying around. I had some new ones, but I've done something a little better for you, man. We threw a set of 454s in this thing for you, man. So It's going to be kind of hard to see them down there, but you got two 454s in this thing now. Two brand new 10 ohms. Let's see. It was disconnected at the relay of the positive coil of the relay. I had to connect that back and pretty much reconstruct how it went back together. It did not go back together the way it was put together. It had a rusty socket head keeping the transistor to the left held down. I went ahead and gave you new screws, new socket heads holding the transistors down. And I had to as well retune the input because these are different transistors. So I retuned the input for you. The output's actually good. I did not have to do anything to the output. So here we go. This is a skeleton 150. So if we can get more than 150 watts PEP with a 4-watt radio, then I say we're doing pretty good, don't you? All right. We got the 4-watt radio. I got the old head apparatus on. Shout out to Mr. Andy G. And I'm gonna quit giving you shout outs, I promise, brother. I won't quit and keep embarrassing you like that. But I'm going to see if I can't show the watt meter just sitting where I'm at. I don't think about it. We got these little alligator clips. Let's see if I can't move this out of the way here. Ooh. Stay up there. There we go. And I'll just kind of zoom in to the watt meter when we're ready to show the wattage, like right now. All right, let's turn the box on. All right, this is a 4-watt radio, 4 watts RMS. Yeah, I'm on peak. Let me put it to RMS real quick. Okay. It gives us about a 30, 40 watt dead key. Right there, about 80 watts RMS. Let's take a look at the peak. There's your 200, talking 200. We talking 200? No, we talking about 190, 190. Ooh, talking. 200 peak, man. So we're already beyond the advertised watts of the box. But this thing wants a little bit more drive, Hobo. So let's give this thing a little bit more drive. We're going to hook up the hot radio. Be back. All right, buddy. We got the hot radio hooked up now. All right, this is RMS. 1,000-watt slug. There we go. It's right there, 160 watts RMS. We're talking. Hey, gatekeeper, ho. No. Nice. No. Hitting right there about 140 to 160 RMS. Let's take a look at the peak. No. Close to 280 watts PEP. So I say it's good to go, man. A little skeleton shown as a skeleton. Let's see, 150, 14.7 volts. Oh, did I show the input reflect? Good God, the money! I can't remember if I did or not. I don't think I did. Input reflect looks good though, Hobo. Mr. Hobo, that's a funny name. I like it. Mr. Hobo on that cot picking end. Yeah, we're going to hook up bench radio back up so we can see the input reflect there. Let's see here. Zoom! Man, we got this skeleton back up and running. I like getting these old boxes back up and running in production, man. These transistors last you a while too, man. 454s, upgraded to the 80 watters, getting about 280 watts peak. I don't see why it shouldn't do about 300. You turn the voltage up a little bit and that kind of good stuff. It's a Class C box. But otherwise, it's up and running, man. Make it a little nice driver or something. All right, Hobo. On to the next one. We'll see you. Bye-bye. Appreciate your patience, too, bud. All right, Mr. Hobo. Mr. George. All right, bud. It's a little dual 1446 box that you got from me a while back off eBay. Just one I had hanging around that I fixed real quick. I remember the primary fix I had to do was install this new relay on it. And, you know, it's been such a while ago, I can't remember the rest without getting back and looking at it. I can tell I added this choke right here on it and everything. But I don't know what happened to it, man. I do know what happened to it, but I don't know why or what caused it. But there was a trace that was blown that was leading the power to the relay. And fix that trace. You can't really see it on camera. It's up under all this. I could tell that you had got in here and attempt to troubleshoot a little bit of it. And I checked the variable, and the variable's still good. So I hooked that back up, and I saw that the 100 ohm right here to ground was about burnt. It's usually an indication of a little bit too much stress on it. There, I mean, that is a 1 watt resistor. That's why I like using these big 5 watters on the variables here, man. Because the more you turn that variable back, the more strain's going to be on the variable itself and that 100 ohm. Because it's pretty much a voltage dividing circuit in a sense, you know. You're taking this 100 ohm pot and turning it into a 50 ohm. The RF sees a 50 ohm variable. But what you're doing is you're doing that to strengthen up the wattage handling of it. But I had something real weird going on with the power LED. As you see, it's working. But what's weird about it, which just blows my mind, I ain't never had this happen before. If you push that LED in more, it won't work. Like, I'm talking about actually pushing in more through the front here. I actually push it in more. It's really weird, man. It had me for a loop there. I even undid it and redid the whole circuit going to the LED and put another resistor on it and everything, man. I didn't know what the heck was going on. Every time I put one in there, I'd test it and it was working. You know, I'd put it right there on the wires and the LED was working. I'd put it in there and push it through and turn it on, and it wouldn't work. And I'm like, what is going on? This is just an LED, man. Why am I having this much trouble? So I don't know. It's like when you press it through that hole, it's putting pressure on the LED, making it not work. So I would just leave it. I mean, it's pretty much even with the other LED, but I wouldn't be pushing on that. You know, I'm talking about actually this direction, pushing it through more. I'd just leave it where it is. And let's see here. Other than that, the only other thing is, see, this box did not come with a variable on it. Okay, there was actually a transmit LED in the middle right here where this variable's at. Somebody put this variable on here. It just had a low and high. So this low and high would not just be sitting here a dead switch. The way they did have it wired up is what it actually did was just disabled the variable. So when you were on high, the variable was disabled pretty much. It was bypassed. And when you were on low, then the variable was working. What I went ahead and did was added big boys race our young girls' butt, 56 ohm resistor right there to ground. Okay, but so you won't get confused. When you flip the switch up, that resistor is active. So that's kind of like low, okay? So just look at this as an on and off instead of a high and low. When you flip it on, that extra resistor is enabled, okay? When you turn it off, it's not. And I will demonstrate that now. All right, we're going to turn it all the way up, variable all the way up. Okay. Like 100 watt slug or a mess. Oh yeah. Well, about there, about 70 or so RMS. Now watch, if I turn it up. Oh, see, it's half that. Alright. Take a look at the peak. Should see about 200 watts.
Yeah.
Right there, about 200 watts.
Yeah.
Alright, we'll turn that switch up. About 150. So now at this point, take that variable and start creeping it down. 80 watts peak. Turn it up just a little bit more. Right there at 100 watts. Turn that jugger back a little bit more. 50 watts. So you got some good control over it. This will make a good driver. Let's make a real good driver. Input reflect. Alright, brother, we got that back working for you, man, and I hope she stays working this time. Make a nice little driver, man, a little 1446 driver. It ain't the strongest two-pill 1446 I've seen, but it's definitely working and working nice, man. I can hit it with that hot radio over there and get about $1.20, $1.30. Maybe $1.40 out of her on the RMS side, but we got her back up and rolling for you, man. All right, so we're gonna go on to the next one, which is not gonna be a fun one. These are not fun to work on. I don't have to explain why. You can look at it and tell why they're not. These bad boys are floating in the air. They are not on any kind of circuit board, and I've already took a look at it, and it looks like you might have a blown pill on this cotton picker right here, which that is not going to be fun to deal with. All right, we'll be back.